I'm going to start with a bathtub. This bathtub is our atmosphere, and there's a certain amount of carbon dioxide in our atmosphere. And I'd like you to know all three of those, the meaning of all three of those levels in the bathtub. And we'll start with a little bit of climate science, if you like, because the whole story today is about carbon dioxide. These are three levels which represent the amount of carbon dioxide in the atmosphere at three different times. The black number is today. There are about 3,000 billion tons of carbon dioxide in the atmosphere right now. 200 years ago, there were about 2,200 billion tons. And 20,000 years ago, there were about 1,500 billion tons. The blue, ice blue, is from the ice ages. And when we have learned from Antarctica about the level of carbon dioxide in the atmosphere, it has gone back and forth between depths of the ice ages, come out of the ice ages, depths of the ice ages, come out of the ice ages. There's about eight cycles. Today we are as far above coming out of an ice age as the depths of the ice age is below. This concentration, so now let me show you that, there are three different units by which one talks about the amount of carbon dioxide in the atmosphere. Billion tons of carbon dioxide in the atmosphere you will not find very often, and you probably don't know this number, 3,000 billion tons, but you can work it out. More common is to talk about the parts per million. So right now when you're breathing the air in this room, 390 molecules are carbon dioxide out of every million. If you were breathing this air, if you were in by the lake 200 years ago, it would have been 280 parts per million. And if you, whoever was around, maybe some animals breathing the air 20,000 years ago, would be 190 parts per million. And there's a, and the connection is that approximately 7.8 billion tons of carbon dioxide is one part per million, something you can work out. And the third unit is tons of carbon instead of tons of carbon dioxide. We'll use the tons of carbon dioxide unit all through today. And the fourth unit, which we can add, is the political unit. This is no more nor less than twice. Red is no more nor less than twice green. It's called, this is this green number, 2,200 or 280 parts per million, is called the pre-industrial concentration. It was quite steady for about 1,000 years, most of Italian history, it's been close to this value. Now it's here, and this number, which is twice, is references. This is called doubling. It means doubling the pre-industrial concentration. We're about one-third of the way to doubling right now, or almost 40%. And this number is climbing 0.5% per year, approximately. So people say, if this is our target, then we have this much more addition to the atmosphere that we're allowed. All of us alive today, future generations in India and Italy and Canada, we all divide this amount, which is called headroom. And so how you're going to divide this amount up among the countries and the people, the rich people, poor people, today and your grandchildren and your great-grandchildren, this is all what the subject is about. Now I just want to notice that this number 390 is about 394 right now. And it's going to cross 400. These numbers are being measured on many places now, but especially the oldest record is from Mauna Loa, a volcano 4,000 meters high on the island of Hawaii in the state of Hawaii in the United States. That's where the first measurements were made. It's an observatory, and it takes samples every half hour or something like that. I don't know exactly. One measure for the first time in about 2 or 3 years will be above 400 for the first time ever since you go back millions of years. The CO2 concentration will be up 400 parts per million, and I think we need an event which your generation needs to create all over the world when the first Hawaii measurement at 400 occurs. It's about 2 years. There's about 2 to 3 years from now. You can start to look at the number and predict, each of you. It'll be a particular flask of air. that has that concentration, 400.0001 or something like that. So when that happens, what should be, how should the occasion be noted in Turin and Milan? Think about it. Invent something. Create a club. Create an awareness of this. This is your job, not your professor's job. It's your job. Okay, now in this sink of 3,000 billion tons, this bathtub, approximately 30 billion tons, or 1%, is being added by burning fossil fuels every year. Approximately 1%. And this number, 30 billion tons, is the global emission rate from burning coal, oil, and gas in the world. Italy's share, we'll learn, is approximately 500 million tons, or between 1% and 2%. Okay? 1.5% is Italy. And it turns out that the rate in which the bathtub level is rising is not equal to the rate at which we're adding, because there are sinks, and I understand you've talked about that already. The forests of the world are getting a little bigger, particularly in the tropics, and the ocean is soaking up some of the carbon dioxide from the atmosphere at the boundary by equilibrium, and it's becoming more acidic in the process. The other thing I'd like you to pay attention to is that if I take 30 billion tons, the world total, and divide by the world population, about 7 billion people, a small number comes out, an easy to remember number comes out, that 4 tons of carbon dioxide per year is the average for the population of the globe. Italy's number is about twice that. It's about 8 tons per capita in Italy. It's about 20 in the United States. It's about 1.5 in India. Tons per person, tons of carbon dioxide per person per year. And we'll be coming back to that number a few times. 4 is the world average. So let's look at the wedge model, which I'm supposed to introduce today. Steve Pakala, who's an ecologist at Princeton, and I wrote a paper in 2004, which was amazingly helpful. I had no idea it would be so useful. But it turned out that people didn't have a language to talk about mitigating climate change, and we produced a very simple way of thinking about it. We drew this graph, first of all. We said, let's look back. Let's keep this unit of billions of tons of carbon dioxide. Here we are at 30 today. If we look back to 1950, it was about 1/5 as much. It was 6 billion tons of carbon dioxide. All this climb has been going on in the last 50 years, 60 years. And there's all that space on the right to ask two questions, and they're the same questions you're going to be asking in your game. One is, if we do nothing at all, consciously and on purpose, to deal with climate change, we deal with other problems. We deal with world oil problems. We deal with that renewables are interesting, that fast cars are interesting, that buildings should get bigger. All kinds of things will happen. What will be the emission rate for the world 50 years from now? 50 years from now. What will it be? And there are all kinds of answers to that question in the literature. Higher, much higher, only a little higher. That's one question. The other question is, if we work very hard to deal with climate change, because we're really worried about it, how much effort is good enough to feel proud of ourselves? I like talking to people who are going to be around in 2062, which you are, and say, okay, suppose I put money in the bank for a party on the boat that you took last night. And you're going to get there. Some of you will have canes, and okay, but you'll be there. Okay? What will be the requirement for the world emissions so that you can have that party? Because you can celebrate 2062. How much global emission is good enough, is far enough down from where we're otherwise heading to be worth a party, deserve a party? And we came up with this very simple picture. We said, if we do nothing, emissions will approximately double. As I said, many papers, thousands of papers are in the literature that give you different answers, but average out to something like doubling the emissions of today, globally. And we could have a party if we don't climb at all over 50 years. Now, there's been an argument about both of those lines after we wrote the paper. Some people said that's not true. It's going to be worse than that. It's going to climb like that. Others said this isn't worth a party. It has to do this to be a party. And you can argue about that. We just drew those two lines, and that was useful enough. And the space in between is the work we have to do because we're dealing with climate change. They're things that wouldn't happen automatically, that take policies and inventions and better designed cities and all of those questions that are done on purpose because we care about climate change, or more generally, that we care about sustainability. Take this whole subject and make it sustainability. Now, this flat curve doesn't get you out of trouble. You're still emitting much more than you're taking away from the oceans and the forests. So we're saying this is a 100-year job. And in the second 50 years, the emissions will fall far enough that whatever the nature can take up will cancel what we're emitting. Maybe this line has to go all the way to zero. Maybe it can go almost all the way to zero, depending on exactly how the forests and the oceans behave. But the point, one second, the point is that this is a first half of a two-step process in our model. Constant emissions and then falling to fewer emissions than today so that it's balanced. There's a hand up.
Yes, I wanted to ask, we are having so much CO2, what can we do with it? Because I'm not a biological engineer or chemistry engineer.
What do you mean by what can we do with it?
Well, how can we use it? How? Because we are having so much of it. Okay. And it so must that the, be something innovative that we can...
Okay, so my whole talk is going in that direction.
Okay.
This is all the introduction. Let's first of all say one more step about the world. And I want to orient the game you're playing to the world. This is in slightly different units, but here we are today, and I'm splitting the world into the OECD. What do you call that in Italian? The letters?
OCSE.
OCSE, which are the Europe, US, and Japan. Huh?
Organization for Economic Cooperation.
Organization for Economic Cooperation and Development. And then the developing world. And today, it's about half and half. About half the world's emissions are coming from the OCSE, and half are coming from the developing world. About four times as many people live in the developing world, so the emissions per capita are about one quarter of as much in the developing world as the developed world. So here we are today with equal amounts in the developing world and the developed world. And my business as usual curve that doubles. Let's say that this is one brown line. These two lines together add up to doubling. But the developing countries do more growing, and the Europe and US and Japan do less growing in the next 50 years. So these two brown lines sum up, add up to the curve you saw before, which was rising. On the other hand, if we go to a flat curve for 50 years, this one, which is Italy and other countries, has to go down as much as this goes up. So a view of what this previous curve means, is that if we go this way, OECD goes down 60%, outside OECD goes up 50%, 60%. And if we go here, maybe OECD goes up 60% and develop 40%, and the developing countries go up 160%. That's what this pair of curves means. And I'm making a fuss about this because you're going to play a game where you are Italy, and Italy is following a curve approximately like this, maybe a little steeper, and you're looking at 2030. That's the time period you're looking at. And this is approximately where you are going to try to be in Italy when you're, if you achieve your game. Here is your curve, which I got from the organizers last night. Your baseline for Italy is flat, not rising. If you do nothing special, your organizers are saying, for the purpose of this game, Italy's emissions will stay where they are today for 40, 50 years at approximately 500 million tons of carbon dioxide for the country, about 1.5% of the world. And if you work very hard, you will meet a goal that was enunciated in Aquila 3 years ago, where the developing world, the developed world would reduce its emissions by 80%, and the wedges game has you do almost the whole job, but for 2030. So this is your game today. And it makes sense. It's consistent with the picture I've been telling you, that the developing countries, you're making it possible for the developing countries to emit more carbon dioxide while the planet stays safe by working so hard in Italy. I hope you follow me. I'm connecting the, we wrote this paper for the whole world. You're doing an exercise just for Italy. It's consistent with the global picture I've been showing you. Because everything, almost all my slides from here on about the whole world, you're going to reduce that, you're going to project that subject onto Italy itself. Now we, Bacala and I had two ideas. One was this stabilization triangle that you just saw, this triangle. The other was to break it into pieces and make those pieces of a particular size, give them a name. We call them stabilization wedges. And they are essentially two index concept. In 50 years, a wedge will allow you to reduce your emissions by this amount. And then you could talk about a wedge of nuclear power, a wedge of efficient automobiles, a wedge of better insulated buildings, and so forth. And we didn't say which were which. We said the game of the world is to reduce emissions by this amount. And in this particular design, there'd be eight wedges. In our original paper, there'd be seven. If you looked at the paper that looked at the world today, it might be nine, defining it the same way. So what is a wedge for the world? It's that 4 billion tons, I hope you all know the G means billion, 4 billion tons of carbon dioxide per year would not be emitted by the world as a result of some special effort of some particular kind. Okay? And so there's this amount in 50 years, adding up, if it's a triangle, to 100 billion tons of carbon dioxide. A price that you might use is say 40 euro per ton. That would be $6 trillion or 4 trillion euro for a wedge. A lot of activity. Now your job is to fill that triangle, same triangle, but a different baseline, a different goal, with 30 wedges that are defined to be smaller than, much, much smaller than the ones we used. They are going to reduce emissions by 5 million tons instead of 1 billion tons. Instead of 4 billion tons, 5 million tons. They're almost 1,000 times smaller. But not in 50 years, only in 18 years. So it's a more compressed horizon in your game, 18 years. It's a much smaller wedge, but it's for Italy, not the world. And at that point, so I'm amazed when I come here and see you playing this game, that what we invented was the concept which in kindergarten is called parallel play. Each kid is doing his own thing. One is playing with blocks. One is pouring water onto a plant. They're all doing different things. So you will be constructing, here are the wedges that you're going to construct, and you choose them from a list, as I'll be showing you in a moment. And then, obviously, if you go further in the future, the idea is these wedges would continue in some fashion. Our paper had 15 wedges. Your game has a list with 20 wedges. About 10, I think, are common to both lists. And I have discussed with the organizers, you are allowed to add other wedges because neither the 15 list nor the 20 list was complete. And you can come up with some new ones. I will have a couple of suggestions of new ones. Okay? The organizers will allow you. It's going to be harder to take a new wedge than to take one of the existing ones, but you'll probably get extra credit if you put one in. Okay? I was a student too. That's what I would do to get a higher grade. Think about this question. When you construct your triangle, you're going to make 30 wedges from a list of 20. So you're going to use them more than once. Ask yourself, say for wind in Italy. How many wedges of wind can I put in? How many wedges of wind can I put in? Will the second one be more expensive than the first or less expensive than the first? And what about the third compared to the second? And the sixth compared to the fifth? Each one is saving 5 million tons of carbon dioxide in 2030. By the way, because by assumption that something else is not being built, and I'll talk about that. There's no right answer for whether it gets cheaper or more expensive. It's something you should discuss in your presentation. If we get smarter and smarter because we keep building windmills, we learn how to do it, they will get cheaper. If, on the other hand, there's only a certain number of good sites in Italy to put a wind turbine, they might get more expensive as you use up the best sites. Each of these wedges has the character that that's an interesting question. Okay? So have that in mind. Now we'll talk about specific wedges for the rest of this talk. So I'm going to split those. I'm going to split the discussion into what I call demand wedges and supply wedges. You're all following me? I'm not going too fast. Okay? Va bene? Okay, so let's talk about efficient uses of fuel. There are three images here. That's the Prius, an efficient car. This is public transport because a city has been developed or redeveloped in a way that reduces transportation demand, particularly private transport demand. And this is very interesting. What's going on here? Somebody is not going to work in his or her car and doing the job from home, and the transport isn't happening. Communication is substituting for transport. I don't think you have a wedge for communication substituting for transport, but it's really important. This is the world of IT, information technology. Can information technology help reduce demand? And we have a calculation here. I don't have time to go through many of these calculations, but let's do this one. The others, we'll just look at them and we won't do them. You get about 4 tons of carbon dioxide if you drive a vehicle 16,000 kilometers in a year at about 8 liters per 100 kilometers. Now, those numbers I think you can relate to. Some cars are better than 8, most aren't. 16,000 kilometers a year is a long distance, except for commuters in Italy. It's not a long distance in the US, in other countries. You'd use up 4 tons of carbon dioxide, and then you would have a wedge if you changed either of those numbers by a factor of 2. If you drive, this is for the whole world, but this is the kind of calculation you're going to be doing, so I wanted to show you what they feel like. So if you drive all those cars but with 4 liters per 100 kilometers instead of 8, you've got a wedge. The 2 billion cars on the world, on the road in the world, are twice as good as business as usual. 8 becomes 4. Or, and here's where your city planners and designers come in here, you have the same 2 billion cars, the same fuel economy, but you drive them half as far because cities have been organized differently. Work is closer to home, other things like that. If you do both, do you get 2 wedges? No. There is a interaction. I have half the cars driving half as far, or half as far with twice as good fuel economy. That saves 3/4 of the original amount, not a whole. Right? It's half time. It's three. You're saving 3/4, and so you have 1.5 wedges. If you get both achievements. So wedges interfere, and there's cross terms. And that's another part intrinsic to the game, something you need to think about when you construct packages. And this afternoon, when you justify your package, you're going to have to note that certain things interfere if you want the extra credit. Now, this picture here at the right, I like this cartoon. Here is a couple. And they are saying, when we retire, I want to watch travel videos. What do you think? How many of you have been to the pyramids? In Egypt? A few. How many of you want to see the pyramids in your lifetime? How many of those who raise their hands can imagine that they would be satisfied if instead of seeing the pyramids with all the smells and the crowds, stay home and watch a very good video of going to the pyramids? All kinds of extra effects, all kinds of places you're not even allowed to go. How many of you would that substitute for going? Not one hand is up. This is actually what climate change is all about. This is really what climate change is all about. We have a love of doing things, and they cost energy. And we have to figure out how to live on this planet, 8 billion of us maybe, all of whom want to see the pyramids, none of whom regard an IT experience as equivalent. How are we going to make that happen? And we do not know, our generation does not know how to do this. You have to figure it out. For electricity, again, three pictures. Efficient electricity. This is a motor controller which uses variable speed drive. It's an engineering solution. This is a planning solution. This is cogeneration, where you deliberately put an industrial use of heat next to a power plant, and use what's called otherwise waste heat. Use it to drive a paper company or a food processing company or something else that needs thermal energy. And over here you have a light bulb, and there's a fluorescent light there. These are not so popular. We're forcing people to use them. We want a better light bulb that people actually want to use. And that's the behavior part. Buildings are playing a big role in your game. Buildings. When we take the energy of the world and break it into this particular way, and this is done for all countries, and it's underlying your game, we can break it into four big categories. Residential buildings, that's homes. Commercial buildings, that's stores, office buildings, government buildings. Factories, industrial energy, and transport. And you see that they're all pretty big for the world total. They're roughly all a quarter. The yellow is the electricity, which has been sent from a power plant to one of these three places. And about 70% of the electricity of the world, this is actually US data. This is US data. World data looks similar, not quite as extreme. 70% of the electricity in the United States that is generated at a power plant is used in a building. Only 30% is used in factories. About half is used in stores and government buildings, and about half is used at home. So a power plant is connected by a wire to a building. If we want to reduce power plant energy, we can have efficiency in buildings, almost one for one. That is why there's so much attention in your game to what's going on in how a building is built and what's happening inside it. And I want you to have that in your head, because why are they talking about buildings? Where's the carbon dioxide in a building? Some of it is in heating the building, with directly burning a fossil fuel in the building, natural gas or oil. But most of it is the electricity use in the building that is connected by a wire to the burning of something, often fossil fuel, on the other end of the wire. You're going to be talking about, this is another way of looking at the same thing. We've been talking about 4 tons of carbon dioxide per person per year. What is that number? Do you remember? It's the world average. 4 tons per person per year. Each of these ways of doing things uses up your whole 4 tons. If you drive a better car, 5 liters per 100 kilometers, but 24,000, you probably don't drive that far. That would use up your whole quota. If you drive 12,000 with that car, you'd use up half of your quota. Your quota is the world average. If you're in airplanes and fly 24,000 kilometers a year, you also use up your quota. For me, that's the one that gets most trouble. Some of the professors would say the same thing. If you heat a home with natural gas, and it's an average home, pretty well insulated, but not super insulated, you probably use up your whole quota too. And if you live in the house with somebody else, you divide that. I live this house in my home with one other person, my wife. So we each get 2 tons of CO2 per year. And if we have lights or appliances or computers or televisions, then we have to know something extra to work out the answer. How carbon intensive is the energy that is on the other end of that wire? And if you have all coal power, which you might have in Poland, you might have in Ohio, in the United States, you can only get away with 300 kilowatt hours a month. If you have some average system that's half as carbon intensive as coal power, it would be 600 kilowatt hours a month. You'll go back to some of these numbers, but these are the kinds of calculations that we're talking about in this unit today. Princeton University has a target for itself. How much carbon dioxide do the buildings of the university use? And if you look at its current emissions and divide by its current population of 12,000 people, it's 9 tons of carbon dioxide for each of us just because we teach there or study there. I don't know if you people have worked out the numbers for the campus of Turin and the campus of Milan, but somebody is paying an electric bill in your university for the electricity they bought. Maybe you're generating some. It's very interesting. So you should have, as a journal club, what's our carbon emissions in Turin and Milan? And then you should compete as to who can bring the number down most. Is that going on already? It ought to. This is the job we have. Yes?
How do you compute this number? Just considering electricity consumption, or do you consider some other?
Very important question. What is the university including in its target? The question of what you're including and what you're excluding in a target is a primary question. It should be a question you ask for your own game. What's included in the Italian total when it's 500 million tons? Is it including any power that's been imported from another country? Is it including your airplanes that are traveling internationally or not? And there's an answer, but you have to look it up. For the Princeton University, this only includes the energy in the university's buildings and a small number of the university's vehicles that are like its own police and its own gardeners. There are a few vehicles and public a bus for the students that are fueled on the campus, but nothing else. The students and faculty driving to work, the students traveling back and forth to their homes, the trips the students take, they're not included here. They could be. Then you'd have a different target and you might have a different percentage goal. What the boundary is and what's included and what is not included is a very important question. So I'm really glad to have that question from you. Okay? I'm going to give you one more demand side wedge. When I talk, I've given a lot of talks about this subject. And when I talk, at the end of it, it used to be that one person would have their hand up and I would recognize them and they would say, I'm surprised you haven't mentioned. And before they finished the sentence, I knew what the word was going to be. And that word was population. Why aren't you talking about how many people there are on the planet? And how many more there are than there were 50 years ago, and how many there will be in 50 years. And I used to say, well, I should include it, really I should include it, but I make excuses. So I've stopped doing that. Instead, I've said, what can I show that gives you a sense of how important population is when you think about the future emissions? And so I show this picture. The United Nations projects the world's future population, and it has 3 official numbers. For 2100, for the world population. 6, 10, and 16 billion people. The high projection is 10 billion people more than the low projection. This is the one you probably hear more about. We expect to have 10 billion people on the planet, says the United Nations, at the end of the century, approximately. They actually say there's the range that they're willing to consider seriously goes from 6 to 16. Huge difference in what kind of life your children will have when they're older people, if it's one or the other. What's the algorithm that generates these three curves? The middle one, which flattens out, has a rule that in the second half of the century, all the mothers have about two children, a little more than two, like 2.1, but all women have two children, on average, for every part of the world. And if you raise that number by a half a child per mother to 2.6, you get 16 billion people. There's an exponential growth in there. If you lower the number to 1.6 mothers, children per mother, you get a falling population, which is down to 6 billion, which is what it was here, around 2000. But it's heading down at almost minus 0.8% per year, and by 2200, the same algorithm gets you to less than 3 billion people on the planet. Without war, without disease, we simply decide to have fewer people on the planet. And so if you want to add another wedge for Italy, ask how many children will be born to the mothers of Italy in 2030, and then in 2050, and then in 2100. There's a population wedge. And in fact, more generally, as my example with the pyramids was showing, this is a problem of being rich. This is a problem of modernity and prosperity. It's not a problem of poverty. It comes because we are becoming more wealthy, we being the whole world. And you want to live a good life. With today's definition of a good life is one lived with exuberance. Not everybody might agree, but most of you are going to agree. And yet, that leads us to want independence, privacy, safety, comfort, beauty, variety of experience, all goals that are in the way, to some extent, of this low consumption life that you're trying to design this afternoon. So the designers in the room must speak up to the engineers and say, yeah, but people like hot water. They like hot showers. They like extra rooms in their house. We've got to be real, and you should have real arguments today about what is sensible. Don't just treat this as an exercise. This is your life that we're talking about. And it's your life. It's your next 50 years that we're talking about. So not only do this, the engineers will be pleased that there is this unit. I'm going to go more quickly because I'm running out of time. But there are supply wedges. Let's talk about how electricity is made, as most of my examples. And we have in the world more and more coal power. Most of the power plants in the world today that are being built are coal power plants. And we have a lot of coal power plants that are getting older, but they're still running. In the United States, there's 300,000 megawatts of coal power running that is mostly 40, 50 years old. Germany has a lot of old coal plants. I don't know what the Italian situation is. A few. Are we going to have coal plants in 2050 or 2030? Or will they have been gradually closed down in favor of something else? So let me make a more general point about the wedges game. You're comparing two futures. You're not comparing the present to the future. People get this confused. You're talking, those two lines in 2030 that look like this over here are two futures. They're not comparing with today. Between now and 2030, will we have built wind farms and closed down coal power plants? Or will we have built wind farms and closed down hydropower? Those are two different answers for how important the carbon is, because if you build a wind farm and close down hydropower, there's no carbon saving. There may be better other reasons why it's a good thing, but it doesn't save carbon. So you always have to say, I'm doing X instead of Y. Not I'm doing X and I used to do Y. So it's comparing two futures. So if I'm going to build lots of new coal power plants, and that's my baseline, then I save carbon by doing something else that has fewer emissions than the baseline. And the way we set it up, Pakala and I, that with 700,000 megawatt coal plants not built would be a wedge. And how many ways are there of not building those coal power plants, each of which is a different wedge? So that was the game that was the way we played this part of the game. So nuclear electricity. Nuclear power plants somewhat substitute for coal power plants, one for one. They both run all the time, called base load. So if we build 700,000 megawatt power plants in the world, I'm not giving you Italian examples, that's for this that's for today, for you. But I'm giving you the global story, and you go back and forth. So it might be a few power plants for Italy. Instead of building 700 large coal plants, I build 700 large nuclear plants, the carbon from the coal plants will not be emitted into the atmosphere. And that's, if I do that in 50 years, that's a wedge, an old fashioned, our global wedge. There is about 350 gigawatts of nuclear power on the planet right now. So if I phase out all the nuclear power in the world, as Germany now says it will do, and I build coal power plants instead of the nuclear power plants, that's going backward by a half a wedge. Tripling the current fleet of nuclear plants in favor of coal, instead of coal, is a wedge. What are you going to say about nuclear power this afternoon? Are you going to say that Fukushima is a very important thing or that we can move past? There's no right answer. It's how you explain your answer. What about nuclear weapons and nuclear power? The United States and Europe are very concerned about Iran with a conventional nuclear power program. It says, a civilian nuclear power program, that it's cover for a nuclear power, for a nuclear weapons program. Is there a risk that nuclear power all over the world, not just in Europe, it has to be all over the world to make a difference to climate change, is going to make nuclear war more likely? Maybe nuclear war between India and Pakistan. Maybe nuclear war in the Middle East. Any of those would be horrible. Is nuclear power bringing that if we bring it on? Or not? Can we have the effective institutions that make that not happen? Photovoltaics, in two versions, on roofs, in the fields. You're going to consider both kinds. Or maybe, actually, I think you have only this kind as your wedge. If you want to add that one, you have an extra wedge. How much land is used? There's a calculation here for how much land is used. And you work out the same number for Italy. Do you have enough land? What does it look like right now in southern Italy where these things are going up? Have you seen them? Do you have pictures of them in your mind? How large are they? Princeton University is putting up 5 megawatts right now on the campus. They use a lot of land. But the university is building it anyway because there are subsidies. Concentrated solar power, on your list. Yeah? I forget. Who remembers? Not on your list.
Extra wedge.
There's a big, how many of you know what desert tech is in this room? Desert tech. Anybody heard of it? Interesting. It's a concept. It's a concept for which Italy would have a big role to build this technology in the Sahara with electric wires running under the Mediterranean to Italy and France and Spain, maybe further, and a significant amount of new electric power would be generated this way in the Sahara, where it's very sunny and where land is pretty cheap, and where some of the electricity would go to North Africa. It wouldn't all come here. That's called desert tech, D-E-S-E-R-T-E-K. Google it. It's a project. It's got a committee. It's got papers about how it would work, finance. And it may be really important for Italy, and you haven't heard of it. So maybe it's too expensive, or too politically complicated, but it's a very interesting option. Something similar can happen in the United States, in our southwest where we have deserts, or even over the border to northern Mexico, which is also desert. We have almost the same option in the United States. Not yet happening, but 2030 could be. Wind, a favorite in all over the world. The amount of wind already built, I keep changing this number every time I make a new, I give this talk, and it goes up and up. We're already at 12% of what we said would be a wedge from wind. We're building at, this is a growing at about something close to 20% a year, every year for 10 years now. An astounding amount of wind is being built. I don't know what the Italian number is. You'll have to dig into that. How much wind? How fast is it growing? What's in the way of it's doing more? Do you put it onshore or offshore? Are you going to allow the system boundary wind that isn't built in Italy, but exports power to Italy from some windy place somewhere else? If there is such a place. All of these are important questions. And are they ugly or beautiful? Do you like looking at wind turbines? How many of you do not like looking at wind turbines? How many of you know that most of the public is different from most of you? Very few hands went up, about five. And yet, sighting of wind turbines on land and near on the shore is really hard in Britain, in Denmark, in Germany, in the United States, Italy as well. So are they ugly or beautiful? Could you make them, you designers in this group, could you make them more beautiful? Could you find a way to make public acceptance of wind farms be a less difficult thing? Do you do that with paying people, compensating them? But can you also do it with aesthetics and with a story? That's another one of our big questions. More technical one and not on your list, this is another new wedge. Instead of building coal power plants, you could build natural gas power plants. There is an amazing new development of the last two or three years in the energy world, which is that it seems as if a whole new kind of natural gas, new kind of place where natural gas is found, is becoming commercially interesting. It's gas that's trapped in rock, in shale rock, and it's called shale gas. And so it's looking as if we could have not build coal plants, but build natural gas plants instead. Natural gas plants will emit about half as much carbon dioxide for each kilowatt hour of electricity that you use. Not zero, but half of the coal value. So if I build 1,400 gigawatts of natural gas instead of 1,400 gigawatts of coal, that will be a wedge, because it's twice 700. So that would be how I would do it. That's an immense amount of natural gas. But we could do it. However, in both cases, we could do better. In both coal plants and natural gas plants, we could actually trap the carbon dioxide before it goes to the atmosphere and put it below ground. That's called carbon dioxide capture and storage. For how many of you is the concept of carbon dioxide capture and storage already a familiar idea? For how many is it not? Now that's... Here's a binary choice. There is no middle. There is no middle. I can't figure out how you could sort of have heard of it. Okay, let's have three categories. I have heard of it. I've sort of heard of it. I've never heard of it. How many have heard of it? How many have sort of heard of it? How many haven't heard of it? There's still nowhere near 100% of the votes. Okay. You're having... I don't know who you are. I don't even know your names. I'm not going to write them down. Okay. The idea is when you burn coal or oil or natural gas or biomass, a product is carbon dioxide. It is not necessary to get the energy out to put the carbon dioxide in the atmosphere. That is a second decision, a separate decision. Where is the garbage pail for the carbon dioxide? Is it the atmosphere? Or do we actually take it away, not let it get to the atmosphere, and put it somewhere else? And that concept of trapping the carbon dioxide and putting it somewhere else while we get the energy out is a very important concept for climate change. And it's one of the wedges you're looking at in your exercise today. And we would do it with coal and natural gas. And this would be what a future coal power plant would look like. You would trap the carbon dioxide and you'd put it below ground in a porous formation, maybe 1 kilometer down. And there's lots written about that, and those of you who are going to do that wedge, you're going to learn a lot about it today. I have a friend named David Hawkins, and this is his sentence about the wedge's game. The wedge model is the iPod of climate change. You fill it with your favorite things. That is what you're doing today. And what's going to happen is that you have to prepare to negotiate with others who have different favorite things. Okay, so in your little groups this afternoon, somebody's going to love nuclear power plants and someone's going to hate them. Okay? And you're going to have to decide whether to put them in your package or not. And you're going to explain why you did it or why you didn't. That's the game. It's the same game globally or for Italy. Few concluding thoughts. One, I don't like any technology, personally. I don't like them. I think that loving a technology is idolatry. Should be forbidden. However, I know we need them. So we have to watch out for what could go wrong. And I like the fact that in your game, there's a lot of attention to what could go wrong when you choose a particular wedge. More than in most of the places I've been where I've seen the game played. You guys are really saying, let's talk about what could go wrong and what could go right. So how much conservation are we willing to... My hand in my pocket, and that's what does that. How much conservation are we willing to live with? Are we willing to put a maximum, say no vehicle can be on an Italian road that gets more than 5 liters, needs more than 5 liters to drive 100 kilometers. No Italian home can be more than 80 cubic meters. No refrigerator can be bigger than a certain size. How much regimentation are we willing to live with? Restating that, how much regimentation are you willing to live with? Because this is your grown-up years we're talking about. With renewables, how much land change are we willing to live with? How many farms in southern Italy get PV? Do we need any farms? Should we just put PV everywhere, wall to wall, coast to coast? Clean coal, capture the carbon dioxide. Do we care about the miners? Do we care about the land change with the coal industry? Nuclear power, I mentioned nuclear war, also nuclear accidents, also waste disposal. Geoengineering we haven't talked about, but some people think we just are never going to get rid of fossil fuels. These wedges are just imaginary. We'll never get them done. And then do we want to do something to the planet as a whole to compensate? Do we want to become geoengineers? You're going to hear more and more about that, and you're going to be making decisions about that. So I think this whole problem should be thought of as risk management. Choosing targets, we take account both of the risks of disruption from climate change and the risks of disruption from mitigation. These are mitigation opportunities. Can a target be too strict? Is the Aquila target too strict, unrealistic, and actually counterproductive, or not? That guy, Hippocrates, lived across the Ionian Sea from you, right, a little while ago. And he said, in modern English, I will apply for the benefit of the sick all measures that are required, avoiding those twin traps of overtreatment and therapeutic nihilism. Big words. Overtreatment, every hospital doctor has to decide, do I try this experimental drug? If a patient is very, very sick, maybe I will. If they're not so sick, maybe I won't. I want to avoid overtreatment. Therapeutic nihilism means I can't do a thing. I wish I could do something. I can't do a thing. Those are not two words, must be quite similar in Italian for those words. Yeah, very similar. So you understand. Still, I'm an optimist. The world has a terribly inefficient energy system today. Carbon emissions have just begun to be priced. Market forces would help if we could agree to carbon prices and tighter cap and trade systems and so forth. Most of the physical plant of the world has not been built. Most of the Italian physical plant maybe has been built, but there's still going to be many new communities, much repair of the buildings. You can look around and say, how many of the buildings I'm looking at are going to be here in 50 years? That's for the architects to tell the engineers. And if they're going to be different ones, what are they going to look like? And if we're going to have to fix the ones we have, what does that mean? And which choice do we make? And very important in my optimism is this last item, that many smart and committed young people now find energy problems exciting. That means you. That's why I'm optimistic, because of you. So finally, our planet Earth is the only one we have. Fortunately, Our science has discovered threats fairly early. We can identify a myriad of helpful technologies, and we have a moral compass that tells us to care not only about those alive today, but also about the collective future of our species. We don't want to trash the planet and let our kids and grandkids feel the entire consequences. What has seemed too hard becomes what simply must be done. Now go play poly game.